Well, good morning and welcome to Marine View Church Online. My name is Jesse Skiffington and I serve as pastor here at Marine View. And I want to welcome you today as we continue in our journey, our mission here, to go deeper with Jesus and to reach wider with his love. One of my favorite things about being a part of the Marine View family is that we have a wide range of folks when it comes to where people are in their life and faith. We're an intergenerational community. We have people from all ages and stages of life, and we come together to love and serve God and to love and serve each other. And we have people who are brand new to faith, not sure what to make of the whole God thing yet. And we have people who have been following Jesus for their whole lives. And together, we're doing our best to take steps to grow in the love of Jesus and then to share that love with those around us. So I'm glad you're tuning in today, and I hope that you'll join us in that journey. Today, we're continuing in our study of a letter in the New Testament called Philippians. It's written by the Apostle Paul. He's a key leader, a missionary in the early church in the first century. He's establishing Christian communities around the Greco-Roman world, and now he's writing to one of those churches the church in the Roman city of Philippi. And Paul had been there when the church started, and now he's writing to them years later from his imprisonment in Rome. Paul's waiting his potential execution there and wondering what will happen. And so he's writing to them, and sort of by extension to all of us, and more than anything else, he wants them to remember that Jesus is at the center of their faith, that Jesus is to be the ultimate orientation for our life and faith. In Christ, we are oriented to a way of life that seeks to live and love and serve like Jesus, to see the world around us through the lens of our faith in Jesus, and to grow in that as the Holy Spirit, which was promised by Jesus, comes into our lives and helps us to become more and more the new creation that we were created in Christ Jesus to be. We love because he first loved us. We are loved and rescued by God, and his grace is for us, and he calls us to this new life, and then he invites us to participate in his mission of love, of calling others to be a part of that too. But there are times when we miss it, and we have to be reminded. So to help us think more concretely about all of that today, I want to talk about trust with you. It's one thing to know what you believe. It's another thing to trust what you believe by putting your belief into action. Trust is related to, but is different from belief. Trust is shown. Trust is shown through actions. We demonstrate our trust by acting on our beliefs. Now, a belief is an intellectual exercise and does not rise to the level of maybe what we would call faith without a corresponding action that shows our trust in what we believe. So this week, of course, is Super Bowl week. You're going to watch the game later today if you're watching this in real time on Sunday. The Seahawks are not in the Super Bowl. Again, it's been a while. This is, however, the 10th anniversary of the Seahawks' win in the big game against the Denver Broncos. And I was listening to some interviews this week on Sports Talk Radio, and I was fascinated by the way members of that team talked about their sort of their mentality as a team going into that game. Not only did they believe they would win, they really had something like faith in their ability to win. They believed and they trusted, and they put it into action. And that was particularly true on defense. Here's a picture of their defense rallying in that game. The Seahawks ran a really simple defense. Basically, everyone lined up and did their job. They didn't try to trick anybody. And as a team and as an individual, they believed that they could all do their part. But belief and trust are related. They're different things. They're related. It takes a lot of trust to let someone else do their job and not try to do it for them. In fact, that's where a lot of defenses fail. They claim to believe in their defensive strategy, but it doesn't show up in their actions. And people try to overcompensate for each other and do things, and they don't actually trust the system or each other enough to just go for it. Sometimes it's a talent gap, but more often, it's a lack of trust. Even though I say I believe my teammates are going to do their job, if I don't trust them to do their job, I might leave my assignment to go and try and do it for them. Well, that year, the Seahawks did not fall into that trap. And if you watch that defense any time throughout that year, but particularly in the Super Bowl, you can see that trust lived out. It's amazing, and it led to amazing outcomes. And trust, when lived out, can lead to those amazing outcomes. That game was one of the most lopsided in Super Bowl history, and it was an outcome of a defense that not only knew the scheme and believed in it, but translated that into something like trust, into individual actions. And team actions on the field. And I think that's somewhere of the breakdown that can happen in our lives as Christians. We might say we believe, and we might have an intellectual desire to believe, but it doesn't always show up on what we may call the field of our faith, out there in the real world, if you will. It's like we know about the Christian life, and we know about what Jesus said, and we know about what we are supposed to believe. The struggle isn't our belief so much, or even knowing what Jesus asks of us. It's our trust. It's our putting that into action. Do we put what we know and believe about who Jesus is and what Jesus said and did and taught into action in our lives? Is our belief in Jesus showing up in our actions? Well, I want you to think about that for a moment. In your desire to live a Christ-oriented life, is what you believe about Jesus showing up in your real life in a real way? Now, that's one of the hard things to be honest about. It's hard to be honest with ourselves and take an honest look. And one of Pete Carroll's innovations with the Seahawks was this implementation of a practice called Tell the Truth Mondays. The team would watch the film of the previous day's game and then tell the truth about what happened. Where were the breakdowns? What went well? What didn't go well? And how do we get better? And how do we hold each other accountable and all that? And it takes a lot of trust as a team to do that. But that's what I like about this approach. There's some accountability in here. And Pete Carroll knew what we all know, that human beings like us, we're really great at self-deception. Sometimes we need to help each other see what's going well, what isn't. The film doesn't lie. You can see it. I wonder what would happen in your life or my life if you kind of had film to look at once a week of how it's going in this life with Jesus. What would it say about you or me in our Christ-oriented life? Okay, I get it. That's pretty intense. I want you to remember, as we're talking about this, that God loves us. He wants what is good and best for us, and he invites us to trust him, to participate with him in that by translating our belief into action, to trust him. In the Christian life, we have a word for that kind of trust. It's called obedience. Obedience, or doing what Jesus asks us to do, is an act of trust. It's not a threat like do it or else. It's an invitation to trust the one we claim to believe in, to trust in such a way that what he says matters most shows up in the way we live in our real lives through what we actually do. Some of the reformers of the 16th and 17th century point to obedience as a response to our salvation, our new life with Jesus. Obedience is not a condition of our salvation. It is an invitation to trust more and more. It is an outcome or a response to what God has done for us, so that we can experience more of his presence and become more and more who he created us to be. So all that being said, let's jump into our passage today with an eye towards trust and obedience and all of that, a lived faith. So open your Bibles up to Philippians chapter 2, and we're going to begin in verses 12 and following. And we're going to see just before this, Jesus modeled obedience and humility for us. He showed us what servant-hearted trust looks like when he's obedient to death on a cross for us. And it led to the most amazing outcome of all, the forgiveness of sin, the healing of creation, and the power of God to bring life out of death. So in light of what Jesus has done for us and what he has shown us in his own example, Paul challenges us to have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. And after pointing to who Jesus is and what he's done, Paul writes these words in Philippians chapter 2, verse 12 and following. He says, "Therefore, in light of all that, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purpose." Now, we'll get to the fear and trembling thing in just a moment, but I want you to notice here that Paul once again reminds the Philippians that they're on the right track. Whatever the circumstance, whether Paul is able to be with them or not, or whatever they're going through, whatever situation they face, they can demonstrate their ongoing trust in Jesus through their obedience. Ongoing obedience is a faithful response that demonstrates an ongoing trust in Jesus. You trust and you obey, and then you do it again. And as you obey, Paul says, you're continuing to work out your salvation. Now, that's a strange way to say it, I think, at first, and we're going to look at this just a little bit. Wouldn't it have been maybe more cohesive or easily understood if Paul just said, as you have obeyed, continue to obey? But that's not what he wrote. He said, as you obey, continue to work out your salvation. Paul is pointing us towards something crucial here that is, I think, an essential for us to understand in our present Christ-oriented life. And it's this, that our salvation in Christ is past, present, and future. It's something that has happened through Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. It is finished. We are justified. We're made right with God because of what Jesus did. That is true. We have been saved. But it's also something that is happening in us now. We are being saved. We are becoming more and more like Jesus. His nature is becoming more and more like second nature to us. It is the present transforming work of the Holy Spirit that is saving us. And it is the future. It's as in it will happen one day. Our salvation is on the horizon when we will be whole and alive forever, when we are made into the very image that God made us for and set free from sin, when Christ returns and we pass from this life to go and be with the Lord. It is something to look forward to. Another way to put it, that it maybe is this: we are saved, we are being saved, and we will be saved. When Callie and I were first engaged, we visited friends and family up in LeConnor where I grew up. And my buddy Josh and I thought, let's take the boat out and we'll go out to Friday Harbor from LeConnor and out there in the San Juans. And so that's what we did. It was a bit of a bumpy ride on the way out, but it was a beautiful day in the end. And we made it out to Friday Harbor and it was really great. We had a good time walking through town and grabbing a bite to eat before we headed toward the marina to make the journey home back to LeConnor. The only problem was is that we forgot to fuel up when we got to Friday Harbor, and the gas dock in the marina closed at 5, and it was now almost 6 p.m. We had a half a tank of gas, and Josh thought, well, I think we can probably make it. Remember, we were about 24 at the time, and we were a bit braver then, so we headed out with a half a tank of gas. Now, I should add that Callie and I had watched a show about a kayaker in the San Juan Islands who had gotten swept out into sea through the Rosario Strait and then out into the Strait of San Juan beyond that. It's not exactly the picture you want in your mind if you're not used to boating in the Puget Sound. And maybe as you're looking at the gas meter go down and down, kind of makes the crossing a little bit harder with hardly any fuel left. Yeah, but here's the thing. That kayaker that we watched, he'd been rescued. He was saved. The boat came to rescue him, saved him. But imagine having found him if they said, okay, you're saved. And then after making sure he had some food and water and was doing okay, they threw him back into the water in his kayak and pointed to the distant shore and said, there it is, go for it, good luck. We saved you, now get after it. No, they saved him, but then they continued to save him as they brought him into their boat. They put a blanket on him, they cared for his needs, they rehydrated him, they made sure he was okay, and they helped him kind of come back to life, so to speak. They continued to save him to help him be whole again. And then they saved him completely when they put his feet back on dry ground. The rescue wasn't complete until then. We are saved, as in we are rescued by Jesus from our sin and selfishness. And we are being saved. We are being made whole again. And we will be saved. In the end, when we go to be with the Lord, Jesus saved us. He is saving us. He's bringing us back to life and helping us be whole again. And it's something we grow into. And he will save us in the ultimate sense through our life with him forever one day. Now, in case you're wondering about Callie and I in the boat, our boat didn't, in fact, make it back to LeConnor, but it did make it to Washington Park in Anacortes, where we coasted into the dock as the last fumes of gas were being burned. And our friend Andy came with his truck, and I think Mario was there too. And they had a boat trailer, and they brought us the rest of the way home. So we made it. We did okay. But it's that middle part, the we are being saved part, we are being made whole part, that has to do with our life of obedience now. We are saved by Jesus. We are rescued by him. And now we get to grow in that salvation. Obedience is this gift from God because of his love for us. When we are obedient, it grows the love of Jesus in us. And when we do what Jesus asks, even when it's hard or we don't understand, we do it as an act of trust in the goodness of God. In theological terms, we talk about this middle part, the we are being saved part, using the word sanctification. We are being made more holy. We are being made more and more like Jesus, more and more holy as God works in our lives right now, today, in the real world. Sanctification is the present activity of God's saving work in our lives as we're empowered by the Holy Spirit to live more and more Jesus' way, to do less of the things that we know we ought not to do anymore and to do more of the things that Jesus calls us to love and serve, to lean more fully into our Christ-oriented life through obedience, through trust. That's how we're working out our salvation, growing in it by becoming more whole, healthier, and healed, growing more and more into the person God made us to be. Another way to put it, our salvation is being worked out. We become more like Jesus and by extension, like who we are created to be in Christ Jesus as we trust him and put his commands into action. It is as we trust as we obey, as the Holy Spirit works in us, that we find our salvation being worked out. We're growing in that. Now, Paul uses a pretty strong phrase here. He says our salvation is being worked out with fear and trembling as God continues his good purpose, his good work in us. And Paul is saying, I think, to us, is that what's going on here is a big deal. This is not a small thing. The God who created the heavens and the earth and everything in them knows you by name and loves you and has sent his son Jesus to die for you so that you could be saved and that you could grow in that salvation. That's a big deal. And it deserves respect. It deserves awe and even wonder. When we do what Jesus asks, what God asks of us, it's not only for our good, it's for the good of the ongoing refinement and the working out of our salvation, and it's for the good of the world around us. And our obedience is a faithful response to that, a trusting response that demonstrates our awe and wonder toward God. Isn't it amazing what God has done for us? How awesome, how wonderful, how precious. Work that out with fear and trembling. Take it seriously. It is weighty. But sometimes instead of treating our salvation as a precious gift and our ongoing obedience as a reverent way to work that gift out and grow in it, we can sometimes turn inward again and forget what has been done for us. Or we can begin to turn maybe on each other and complain about the difficulties of the Christian life in a really challenging culture and world. And Paul understands that. He sees that. He says, work out your salvation. Grow in your obedience. Keep going. But be careful. And he writes, do everything, do all of this without grumbling or arguing so that you may become blameless and pure, children of God without fault in a warped and crooked generation. Live a life of obedience and love in such a way that you stand out. Now, I don't know what church is, Paul is talking about, because none of us would ever do that here at Marine View, but the Philippians apparently struggled. It's a hard thing to live and love like Jesus. And we can get frustrated about that, and we can get frustrated with each other and with the difficulties and suffering that can come with living for Jesus in a world that doesn't get it about Jesus and is increasingly hostile to the church. Paul says, don't grumble. Don't argue. Keep trusting, instead. Keep trusting in the way of Jesus. Grumbling, that's sort of like quiet murmurs in the crowd, muttering under your breath, or I'm sure you've been there. It's that frustration that sort of bubbles up and you can't help but get irritated and you sort of grumble along the way. And it has an impact on your heart if you're not careful. And people can see it on your face and it's not a good look, Paul says. Don't be murmurers. Like that's not a good look in this world. Figure out how to set that aside. Neither is arguing with each other, Paul says. We might call that a noisy dispute. Now, I love good discussion and discernment. And we should do that. And yet, arguing when you're no longer listening to each other and you're more or less trying to shout each other down to get your way, that's not a good look. Grumbling, complaining, arguing, it demonstrates something of a broken and strained trust. Think back to the Seahawks for just a minute. The year after they won the Super Bowl, something just wasn't quite the same. It wasn't quite right. This team was still really, really good. They were, in some ways, maybe a better, more mature team, it seemed, but there was something in the air the year after they won the Super Bowl. There was a grumbling, sort of a murmuring about quarterbacks and cornerbacks and who got the limelight, who is the strength of the team, all those things. And trust, you could feel it, was beginning to break down. It was the same team, but what a big difference a year makes. And so after miraculously beating the Green Bay Packers in overtime to get back into the Super Bowl, the Seahawks had a chance to win back-to-back Super Bowls. That's a pretty rare thing to have an opportunity to do. And they almost did it. But as you know, in the end, they didn't get it done. At the most crucial moment, trust really failed. You might remember this picture. I'm sorry, I hate to show it to you, but sometimes hard things help us. That was brutal, wasn't it? Hard to watch, hard to get over. And I get it. The coaches and all them thought, let's trick them. We're going to pass it instead of handing the ball to one of the best running backs in NFL history. But in my opinion, that's where trust that was already failed. What had gotten them there was a strong defense and a solid running game and a carefully managed passing game that played off of the running game. And even now, when I see what happened in that replay, and I see that moment, I can't help but shout at the screen, just run the ball! Just run the ball. Of course, that was the beginning of the end for the Seahawks and their Legion of Boom and all those good days, wasn't it? Grumbling turned to arguing, and it was never quite the same. We've had plenty of other fun moments with the Seahawks along the way, but none were as good as they might have been. When trust breaks down, something goes missing. Paul urges the Philippians to continue in obedience, to trust, to work out their salvation, to put their belief into action, because the outcome is worth it. The outcome in the Christian life is something beautiful, even more beautiful than a Super Bowl win. Though that's pretty good too. Paul says when you keep trusting, you keep obeying, you keep on going without grumbling or complaining or arguing, when you do, Paul says, you will shine like the stars. He says, in our life of obedience, even when it's hard and difficult, and we can trust that we're being transformed to shine more and more like Jesus. He writes, then you will shine among them like stars in the sky as you hold firmly to the word of life. And then I will be able to boast on the day of Christ that I did not run or labor in vain. Paul doesn't want any setbacks for the Philippians. He wants them to shine. He wants their love for Jesus to shine. Our Christ-oriented life is intended to stand out like a light in the darkness. We are created in Christ Jesus to shine the light of God's love, to do good works that tell the story of his goodness and glory, to show that through our trust, how good and loving God is, knowing that he has our best and the good of others in mind. Paul knows in this moment that his death may be on the horizon, and he invites the Philippians to rejoice in the opportunity to experience the ongoing presence, the ongoing transforming work of the Holy Spirit, the goodness and love of God through their obedience, rooted in trust. Now, we didn't get to the whole passage today, but in the remainder of the passage, I just want to talk about a couple things that happened here, because Paul lifts up two particular people. And there are two people who have demonstrated a Christ-oriented life through their obedience. They have shown a growing Christ-likeness, a trust in who Jesus is and what Jesus says matters most for the way we live. So Paul provides it in the remainder of our passage, two examples of people who shine like stars in the sky, of exactly who he hopes that the Philippians will grow to become and continue to be. And these people are Timothy and Epaphroditus. You could read what Paul says about them in verses 19 through 30, Philippians 2, 19 through 30. But Paul lifts Timothy up as an example of Christ-like humility. He talks about their relationship and how Timothy's a young man that Paul's mentored and discipled in the way of Jesus, and he has helped him on his journey to trust Jesus in his words and actions, and Timothy has kind of learned this way of humility that sets an example for us. And then Paul also mentions this other guy, Epaphroditus, and he appears to have been sent by the Philippians to bring financial support to Paul and to be a source of encouragement to Paul in his imprisonment. Epaphroditus served like Christ, and he sets an example for the Philippians and for us what it looks like to serve like Christ, to be selfless and giving. Paul had mentored and discipled Epaphroditus too, and he was ready to send him back to Philippi after a close call with a serious illness. Paul discipled them both, Timothy and Epaphroditus. To disciple means to help follow in the way of Jesus, to give them something of a step in their life with Jesus. These two examples are a case study in one of the ways that we are called to ongoing obedience. Not only are we growing more and more into the likeness of Christ, being transformed as our salvation is worked out in the presence, so we are also commanded by Jesus to help others to follow Jesus more closely too, to help others to grow in their trust, in their transformation, and to work out their salvation. Jesus gave us what we call the Great Commission, and he gave that to those who put their trust in him. Not only are we to put our own trust in Jesus, but we are to help others to do that too, to help each other grow as we follow in the way of Jesus and live out this Christ-oriented way of life. One way we practice obedience is by doing what Jesus asked, to make disciples. Just before Jesus ascended into heaven after his resurrection from the dead, he gave this commission to his disciples. These words may be familiar to you if you've been around the church. We've looked at them many times here at Marine View. But Jesus said, therefore, go. Go and make disciples of all nations, all people, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. Go and make disciples. Well, we make disciples when we help others to follow Jesus from where they are, to take steps forward, to grow more and more into the person Jesus made them to be. Disciples of Jesus help others to follow Jesus too. We seek to demonstrate our faith through trusting obedience, and we invite and challenge and teach others to be obedient to Jesus too. Another way to put it, we help each other to live a Christ-oriented life and then to grow in that. And here's something really great about this vision of making disciples, of helping someone else to follow in the way of Jesus too. You don't need to be a spiritual giant to disciple someone. You just need to be a step or two further down the road with Jesus. This is not just for the spiritual elite. This is for all of us, to look around and trust Jesus when he says, I am with you, and I am asking you to be obedient, to help someone else take steps to follow me too, to move forward in their faith as well. As much as I wish that Pete Carroll and his coaching staff had decided to run the ball, I've always respected how Pete wanted his coaches to grow and develop and then to achieve their own goals and dreams. He was pouring into them so that they could become the very best version of themselves. We have the privilege of doing that for each other in our life of faith. We do that for other believers. We help each other to work out our salvation, to grow in our obedience, to be sanctified through the ongoing transformation of our hearts and lives, becoming more and more like Jesus, following him more closely, with each of us trusting in him. So where do we go from here? How do we get the rubber to the road and all that? Well, I want you to maybe look around in your life. Maybe not literally look around, but look around in your life and ask yourself, is there someone in your life who is a step or two further down the road of life and faith that you can learn from and be encouraged by and that might be able to help you follow Jesus more closely? Maybe ask yourself, whatever season that you're in, who can I learn from as I seek to follow Jesus more? Then maybe do something outrageous, like invite them out to coffee or ask if you can talk sometime. And if someone asks you if they can invite you out, please say yes, even if you don't feel qualified. That's probably a good sign that you're the right one for the job. So look around in your life. Who might help you? Who's just maybe one or two steps further down the road that can help you follow Jesus more closely? A second question is a related one. As you seek to be obedient, you probably guessed the question. As you're trying to demonstrate your trust in Jesus through your actions, as you're working out your salvation, as you are being transformed, as you are following in the way of Jesus and being led there, ask yourself, who can I help to grow as a disciple of Jesus? In my life, is there someone that Jesus has put there that I can help on that journey of faith? If you trust Jesus, this is not optional. In fact, if you trust Jesus, you're called to be a disciple and to disciple others, to grow in your obedience because you believe deeply that God loves you and this will be good for you and it will be good for those around you, to grow in faith, to deepen your trust, to work out your salvation. So your homework this week is to think and pray about those two questions and then to risk acting on whatever answer surfaces. Who can I learn from as I follow Jesus? Who can I help grow as a disciple of Jesus? That kind of obedience rooted in trust can lead to amazing outcomes. Now, next week, we're going to come back as Paul gives us another important image for our faith, running a race, pressing on. We're going to look at Philippians chapter 3, 1 through 14. And in the meantime, I'm going to pray for us, and I'm going to ask the Lord to help us to obey his commands because we trust him and trust that what he asks of us is good for us, and it's because of his love for us and his love for the world. So let's pray and ask the Lord to help us to trust and obey, to help others to follow Jesus more closely, even as we seek to follow Jesus more closely. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for the time that we've shared together in your word and the ways that we're challenged to live out our faith in the real world in a real way. Help us to trust you enough to put what you say matters most into action in our lives, to lean into that, to be disciples who are following your way more closely and seeking out help with that, to be discipled. And then help us to look around and see who we might help on the journey to follow you more closely too. Who can we disciple? Who can we help in that journey of faith? Thank you, Lord, that as we are obedient in that way, that you will meet us there with your provision, your presence, and your spirit to grow us more and more into the image of Jesus Christ, into the new creation that you call us to be. I thank you, Lord, that you have saved us, that you are saving us, and that one day we'll get to be with you forever, free from sin, free from the things that make it hard. We'll know your presence fully. I thank you, Lord. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.